Welcome to the lecture series on computer organization. Today we will discuss about the memory hierarchy and how RAM chips and ROM chips are connected to CPU. So first we will see the basic block diagram of the computer, how the different devices are interconnected in one way. You have the CPU and you are having main memory and cache memory and secondary storage devices. Actually, our memory is divided into two types of devices. One is a primary storage device and another one is secondary storage devices. So if you see these two categories, magnetic disk, optical disk, they will come under secondary storage devices. Whereas magnetic disk, they will come under main memory, they will come under primary storage devices. Here if you see the difference between main memory and magnetic disk is magnetic disk is non-volatile. That means even if power is switched off, this magnetic disk contents will not be erased. Whereas in main memory, when you switch off the computer, the contents will be erased. So you cannot directly connect all the devices to the CPU directly. You should take the help of some controller. You can take the help of controller, or in our case, you can write it as input-output processor also. So there will be some interfacing circuits. With the help of interfacing circuits, you will connect to the main CPU. Here also the same case. Again, you may ask, sir, what is the need in having different types of memory? Different types of memory. The main reason is the difference in speed. CPU executes the instruction in the order of 10 power minus 12 or minus 16 also, sometimes minus 16 seconds. Whereas main memory accessing speed or magnetic disk, magnetic tape, it is very slow. So if you use only one type of memory, most of the time the CPU will be in idle state only. Thereby you are underutilizing the power of CPU. That is the main reason why different hierarchy of memory is followed in designing the computer. Let us see the hierarchy. So the top level register, next level cache, and third level main memory, fourth level magnetic disk, magnetic tape. If you see all these things, first four blocks, 1, 2, 3, 4, these four are present in the computer itself, whereas these are present in outside the computer. Once you store the data, and you can remove the tapes. Actually, this is used for permanent storage purpose. Coming to magnetic disk, it is also present inside the computer. When you compare the sizes of magnetic disk, magnetic tape, magnetic disk is having somewhat lower size than magnetic tape. But nowadays, we are having a good, because of technology advances, we are able to have a huge amount of magnetic disk also. You should understand that these first four, they are present inside the computer. These two last two blocks are non-volatile. Coming to this, this register, cache, main memory, they are situated very close to CPU. Main memory is made up of main memory is volatile, and cache and register, all these three components are volatile, and all these first three components are present very close to CPU. So if you see this, the register is present in the processor itself, and cache is present because of technology, now it is present in the processor itself. And main memory is present outside the processor. So whenever the CPU wants to gets the instruction first, it will check in the cache. If it is not found in the cache, you know, it will search in the main memory. So you should understand that all our operating system programs are present in the magnetic disk. When it is powered on, the OS will be transferred into main memory. So from main memory only, the processor starts executing the programs. So if you want to run a program, that program has to be transferred into main memory. Then only it will be executed. Then if you ask what is the purpose of these two components, register always holds the intermediate results. It is for storing the temporary results. Okay, whereas catch is used for storing the frequently used instructions or frequently used subroutines. So comparatively, if you compare the cache and main memory, cache is very fast because it is located inside the processor. So whenever the processor needs to execute a instruction, first it will search in the cache. If it is not found, then only it will go into main memory. So if still it is not found, means it will fetch the instructions from the magnetic disk. So actually this transfer of instructions, user programs between magnetic disk, main memory to cache, these are all done in a very, very minute fraction of seconds. So in fact, these are all the job of OS, but to perform the OS, all these duties efficiently, you need to incorporate some hardware design. You need to incorporate certain hardware flexibilities, hardware circuits to support OS functionalities. Okay, this is the hierarchy. If you move from top to bottom, the amount of storage will increase. If you compare between these two, magnetic disk storage is more than magnetic disk. If you move from top to bottom, the time needed to access the data, it will increase if you move from top to bottom. Whereas if you move from top to bottom, the cost of the individual components is decreasing. It will be decreases. So you need to understand that if a processor wants to execute a program, that program has to be brought into main memory from magnetic disk. So whenever a processor observes a set of instructions, a very frequent one, then those will be recorded in cache, so that the CPU need not fetch from the main memory. Why? Because if you compare the speeds of these two blocks, cache and main memory, the speed of cache is very fast. The speed is more, whereas main memory is somewhat less. Coming to our design purpose, let us see how RAM and ROM chips are connected to CPU. So let us take the RAM chips. So for any RAM chip, these control pins are same. Let us observe, these are the control pins. CS1, chip select 1, chip select 2, read pin, write pin, and address data 7 bit address. You will have address pins and you will have 8-bit data pins. So let us assume this is the RAM chip. For this RAM chip, these are the pins. So 1, 2, 3, 4 control pins, And since it is a 128 by 8 type of RAM, that means it stores 128 bytes. That means it is having 128 locations. For accessing 128 locations, you need 7-bit address. So 7-bit address pins are there. So to access the data, 8 pins are there. So now let us see the functionality table. So each variable is a binary variable. So if you write this, you will get this type of table. So if you observe this, if you want to perform the read operation on RAM, first of all, this chip should be selected. So for this chip to be selected, you should give one signal to CS1 and zero signal to CS2. So 1 0. And after that, since you need to perform read data, you need to enable the read pin. And you better disable the write pin. So when you enable the read pin, so whatever the content that is available in address pins, that is treated as address. Basing on that address, the data will be sent on the data pins. In fact, these data pins are connected to data bus. So the data present in that location, it will be transferred to the data bus. Similarly, when you want to perform write operation, means you need to write, that means new data into a particular location. So in that case, you need to select the control pins CS1, CS2. CS1 is enabled by 1 and CS2 is enabled by 0. So by giving 1 0, and you have to give 0 pin to the read pin and 1 pin to the write pin. So since you need to perform write operation, you need to enable the write pin. After that, you give the address where you want to write the data. So the data you want to write is present in the data bus. So whenever you enable these control pins, automatically based on the 7-bit address, the data present in the database, it will be written into the RAM. Only two basic operations are there, read and write for RAM. Read and write. Remaining all conditions, the RAM will be in high impedance state. That means it will be in, acts as an open circuit. It acts as an open circuit. So please analyze the truth table for this functionality, RAM functionality. So once you understand it, it's very simple. Similarly, we are having ROM chip. For ROM chip also, you will have two control pins. Actually, the ROM means, the abbreviation for ROM is read only memory. That means you will only perform read operation only. So let us assume you are having 512 by 8 bits ROM. For accessing the 512 locations, you need 9-bit address. So 9 address pins will be there. 8 data pins will be there. Just you need to select the chip. Chip select is done by 1 0. You need to give 1 to the CS1, 0 to CS2. So by giving these two control pins 1 0, your RAM will be activated, and then based on the 9-bit address, you can read the data present in ROM. Actually, you will store the firmware for ROM. Okay. Now we will see how to connect this RAM and ROM to the processor. Let us assume you want to design a computer with 512 bytes RAM and 512 byte ROM. In this case, we have drawn the block diagram for 128 bytes RAM. So you need to take, since I want to design 512 bytes, you need to take 4 128 bytes RAM. Okay. So RAM 1, RAM 2, RAM 3, RAM 4, and we will assign the logical address like this. For RAM 1, 000 to 007F. We already discussed that the address pins are, let us assume the address generated is 10 bit address. So up to 127 you will use for RAM 1. For RAM 2, let us assume the address that is given is 0080 to 00FF. All these are all in hexadecimal format. For RAM 3, 0100 to 017F. For RAM 4, the logical address given is 0180 to 01FF. For ROM, remaining address 0200 to 03FF. So the same is written in binary format. You can also understand in this way. So whenever the 8th bit and 9th bit of the address is 00, then you can select RAM 1. Whenever the 8th bit and 9th bit is 10, you can select RAM 2. Whenever the 8th bit and 9th bit is 01, you can select RAM 3. Whenever 8th bit and 9th bit is 11, you can select RAM 4. Whenever the 10th bit is 1, you have to select ROM. In this way, you can differentiate. So the same logic you use for connecting the memory to the CPU. So as usual, our processor will have the data pins, address pins. So the diagram is, you take a CPU. Let us suppose it is a 16, you are having a 16 bit address, but in our case, you don't need all the 16 pins address. So you just take 10 bit address. So now what we have done is, we have took, since we need to design 512 bytes, we took 4 RAMs, RAM 1, RAM 2, RAM 3, RAM 4. For each RAM, you connect the output of each RAMs and ROM to the data pins of the CPU like this. You connect the output of each RAM and ROM to the data bus, and after that you connect the read write control pin of CPU to read write control pin of all the RAMs. For ROM, you don't need to connect the write control pin. You just need to connect the read control pin to this one. In fact, there is no read-write control pins. Just you need to have only chip select only. That we will do later. Okay. So after doing this, after connecting all the read-write control pins to all the RAMs, now we will see how to select this RAMs. So if you observe this, our address, whenever 00, 8th bit, if you see, analyze the 8th bit, 9th bit, 10th bit, 000, 100, based on these values, you can select a particular RAM chips, okay? So 00, you take one decoder and you connect the decoder. You connect the decoder to 8th bit and 9th bit of the address pins. So you take the address pins. In the address pins, you take the 8th bit and 9th bit and you connect to the decoder. In the meanwhile, 127 address pins, you directly connect to the address pins of RAM 1, RAM 2, RAM 3, RAM 4, RAM 1, RAM 2, RAM 3, RAM 4. And finally, the ROM. Finally, the ROM. So you connect the 1 to 7 address pins to all the chips of the address pins. Now coming to 8th, 9th pin, you give to one decoder. The decoder, whenever 00, 8th pin, 9th pin is 00, RAM 1 should be selected. So what you do means, you take the first pin of the decoder and you connect to the chip select. And what about chip select 2 pin? So if you observe this, you can connect the 10th address pin because it is all zeros only. So you connect the 10th address pin to chip select. So whenever 8th pin and 9th pin is 10, RAM 2 should be selected. So you connect the second output of the decoder to chip select 1 and the 10th address pin to chip select 2. Similarly, when 8th, 9th pin are 10, the third output of the decoder is connected to third RAM. When 8th, 9th pin of the address pin is 11, you will get output in the fourth pin of the decoder. That means this one. You connect to this, to the chip select of RAM 1. The remaining 10th pin, you connect to the chip select. Now, after connecting this, after all the connections are over, now you have to connect to the ROM. If you observe this ROM, when you have to enable the ROM, if the 10th bit is 1. So you take the output from 10th and you connect to the chip select of ROM. Chip select of ROM. You can see this. In this way, you will connect 4 RAMs and 1 ROM to the CPU. The logic is very simple thing. You connect the output of all RAMs to the data pins of CPU and the read-write control pins to each RAM chips and ROM chips. And then you connect the 1 to 7 data pins to each and every RAM chips and ROM chips, and finally you connect the control chip select pins based on the 8th, 9th, 10th pins. 8th, 9th, 10th pin, you select the RAM chips. For that, you use one decoder, and the output of each decoder is given to a particular chip select pins. So you should understand that for selecting each RAM chip or ROM chip, you need to give 1 to the CS1 and 0 to CS2. Okay. I hope this will clear. So this is how you will connect the RAM chips and ROM chips to the CPU.